Learn everything you need to know to get started with Azure Data Explorer and some tricks on getting started, as well as how this all relates to Fabric real-time analytics this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Matt Gordon. Matt, thanks so much for joining us today again on Data Exposed MVP Edition. It's been a while, but for folks who might not have seen your last episode, can you tell us a little bit about what you do?
For sure, yeah. So I'm a senior architect for Centric Consulting. I'm in our data and analytics arm, so I do some stuff with what we're going to talk about, but I do a lot of other data modernization, AI, perf tuning, you know, all the fun data nerd things.
Awesome. Cool. I love it. All the fun data nerd things. One of those things we're going to talk about today is Azure Data Explorer. Something I've worked a little bit about, but I know folks, there's a lot of people who don't know much about it at all. So I'd love if we could just like kick it off and, you know, you tell us a little bit about what it is, and then we'd love to take a look.
Yeah. So where this came from for me is, you know, we'll go to a lot of customers. They're like, I need my data faster. Or I need insights from my data faster. Faster, right? And they know there's stuff out there to do it. And they always say they want data real time. And while I would say this is near real time, you're getting awfully close. And for most customers, that's enough. You know, we'll kind of introduce this tool. It's like, well, listen, if you're streaming a bunch of data or you've got a lot of time series data to kind of look over, have you heard of Azure Data Explorer? And they have not. So I was like, well, I should, I should tell people about it. So it's nice to be here to have just a few minutes to kind of go over that. But yeah, if you're, you know, there's a lot of streaming data out there now, and companies are asking more and more, even in industries you wouldn't think of. So like, I love racing. I get to drive race cars occasionally. Using ADX across like data streaming off the cars makes a lot of sense to me, but that's the world that my brain kind of wants to live in.
Wow. We'll get, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. Well, I could talk for hours on that. We don't have time for it, but that's one use case for something like this. But the industries we're in, they aren't necessarily things you'd think like, well, real-time data is important, or near real-time data is important. But as you get into it, things coming off point-of-sale terminals and sensors in parking lots and sensors in stores and things like that, you need sometimes a pretty quick way to kind of see that data, maybe catch some early trends, and then take it into different tools or take what you've learned in this tool and kind of present that in some other tools.
Cool. Awesome. Well, I'm excited to learn more about it. I know a lot of SQL heads out there might be like, what is this? So let's take a look.
Okay, cool. So Azure Data Explorer doesn't use SQL. And so for all the SQL heads that you just talked about, it's probably like, oh man, this sounded pretty cool. I'd never heard of it before. But the language I know and love, whatever flavor, T-SQL or something else, I can't use it here. Well, hang around till the end because I'm going to show you how you can. But before then, I'm going to teach you what KQL is, just some of the very basics because we don't have lots of time here. The nice thing is there's great documentation around this. So I'm covering like this much. And but then at the end, if you get through all that, and you're like, man, this KQL is just not for me at all. I've got something for you, so don't leave. So there's a help cluster that's spun up that basically if you have an Azure account, you can use this. So one of the things when you're talking about a tool that runs over big data, it's hard to generate that data yourself, right? You got to go find it or kind of source that out. We've got some stuff here, so I'm using that. So storm events is basically things that happen in bad storms. And so we'll start with the very basics here. So we're addressing the storm events table, which you can see down here, and we're just telling it take five. Now, much like a TV food show, I've kind of had to pre-bake these for time. They ran just before this. So storm events take five is basically I'm selecting my top five rows. You see there's no scroll bar there. So if you're thinking select in your head, like I am, we use take. So now we go over here, and let's say we want to modify that output. We want to change the column names, make it a little prettier. And another thing we want to do is actually add some of the columns together to kind of do some just quick math. Like, well, I don't really care if the injuries happened directly as a result of the storm or as a result of something that happened because of the storm. I just want to know how many folks got hurt, and I want to know how much stuff was damaged or how much money it cost, basically. So I want the first 10 rows of that. So you see we've got a little nicer output. We see the type of event. We see the state. It's debatable whether Atlantic South is a state, but we'll look past that. And then we start to see number of injuries, cost figures, things like that. So that's how we can take a basic query and kind of pretty it up and make it a little more useful. Now we'll come over here. So you might be sitting there and saying, okay, well, I see that and I see how that kind of summarized some stuff. How do I just do like a count? And you do that here. We pipe this data to summarize count and we get that count. Not particularly interesting, but we're going to build on this from here as we kind of go through the samples. Okay, so what we've got here is that, but it's like, I want to know by state. And particularly if you're thinking like over time, are storms in certain states getting worse and damaging more things? Like if you're an insurer or something like that, these are things you might want to know and know pretty fast. So we've summarized that. We've said do the count by state. And then we've introduced a sort here where the syntax is very basic. Mm-hmm. So we've got sort by event count. Got our state, and you see it's sorting from most to least. So, okay, mildly interesting, I hope, maybe more than mild. So let's go to that. So the next thing we've got is we've got the count. But now, because maybe I'm a farm insurer, so I want to know the events with damage to crops, but I only want to count the events where damage to crops happen, where that value's greater than zero. And I want to count, but I want a distinct count. So that's where the D count comes in by state. I still want to sort it by the count that I've established up here. So we get that, but we get it with a little more interesting information kind of on the shoulder there. So we've learned a lot and, you know, kind of dived into a lot of data without doing too much. There's a couple.
So I have one question for you, Matt. I noticed that like lines 2 and 5 have the, whatever that line is called, of your code. When do you put that versus not? What does that mean?
Well, so when you say like summarize versus sort by?
Yeah.
Okay. So basically summarize is like if you're trying to do something that adds up right, and of course we could go down a whole rabbit hole about the way data's modeled and all that, and it's beyond the scope of kind of an ABCs of ADX thing. But if there's additive data and we want to count it, we can add that here. But it's that kind of information, especially when we're doing some notion of a group by, if we don't have some sort of a sort on it, it's not going to be very relevant to us, right?
Right. Yep. Absolutely. Makes sense. And one more question on the, so I think I wasn't speaking clearly. On lines 3 and 4, you have like it tabbed over. Is that just because you're continuing a line? Like which lines need the, and I'm so sorry, I don't know what the name of this symbol is, the straight up and down line symbol that's at the very beginning of line 2.
Yeah, so it doesn't show up well, the way the tool's kind of zoomed in for this. You're basically piping. So I mentioned that, but I think I glossed over it. So that's a pipe character there. So we're taking the data that's all of the storm events table, like we found. It's all 59,000 events, roughly. We're piping it into some stuff we want to have done to it. We're sorting it, and then we're showing it down here. So okay, when you think of kind of the flow of one of these, you're like, you're sourcing it, you're modifying it if you want to, transforming it, adding it, whatever. You're sorting it if you want to, and then you've got your results down here. And on the next thing, you can do something more than just look at a grid.
Oh.
So we've got a results grid here. And for all of our SQL folks and all that, like this is not crazy, right? We've got tables here. We've got views. We have a language that looks a little weird, but we get it. We know this down here pretty well. What about when we get to this part? Well, this part is cool. So this is the query we had over on the last slide with a couple changes. So we're sorting by basically the count and not the distinct count. And I added this clause called render bar chart. Well, based on the visual below, you can kind of see like it rendered a bar chart. And so it's showing these different counts by state. And then over here, so whenever you add this and you execute it, there's a reason that I left this tab up, is because you can come over here and heavily customize what the visual is. So here I've just said, make me a bar chart. And it does. But over here, I can give it a title. I can then add that title. I can change the type. I can change the format. There's a lot of choices here. So if you're thinking about like quick data exploration, and especially for folks that are more visual,
like
you may want to say like, okay, I saw my results grid. I'm having trouble making heads or tails of that, because generally the data you're looking at is large. There's rows and columns everywhere. Make me charts, and it can do much more than bar charts. Make me a chart, and then you're going to pick up on some stuff faster. And then it's really easy over on this side of my screen that I'm pointing to, which is not helpful for anybody but me. So where you can adjust that and kind of get that visually where you want. Pretty cool.
Awesome.
And again, pretty quick. This stuff, like I said, if I had to run all this, it would have taken a couple minutes. So last but not least, so we talked about the SQL heads, and I said, hang around till the end, because there's something for all of us. Here it is. That may not seem so exciting, right? So I have a comment. I've put the word explain. I have a query, but it's T-SQL. So when I come down here and double click on it, my T-SQL that I know and love turned into KQL that ADX knows and loves.
Oh my goodness. I had no idea you could do this.
Yep. So it kind of brings us back to the start where I set a select. It's like a take. So you see, because of the flow and the way the data is piped, we've got our select kind of down at the bottom, which makes more sense here than it did at the start. We've got our sort above that, showing nulls first. But yeah, this is basically T-SQL to KQL magic.
That's so cool. You could basically start doing this, just write T-SQL if that's what you know how to write. And then, you know, you'd learn pretty quickly.
Yeah, it's syntax that makes a lot of sense to me. I don't want to admit how long I've been working around T-SQL and things like that, but it's been a minute. This isn't a huge leap. And that explain really makes it so much easier, because sometimes your brain does just freeze up and you're like, well, I don't know what that is. And rather than looking it up, you can just ask. And this will always give you a good start to what you're trying.
Awesome. Cool. Well, hey, Matt, thanks so much for coming on the show. I do have one question for you as we wrap, and that's obviously got to be Fabric related. We're hearing a ton about Fabric and this thing called Fabric Real-Time Analytics. What's the story with Azure Data Explorer here?
So Azure Data Explorer is a PaaS service in Azure. So if you heard the word Fabric and you're like, that's not for me, we're not using it, whatever, that's fine. Everything I just showed you here, ADX is its own standalone thing. What real-time analytics is it's a software as a service offering, because it's under the Fabric offering. It brings the ADX engine and KQL and all those sorts of things kind of under the Fabric umbrella and lets you hook it to some of the other things that live under that umbrella as well. The core engine is the same, and what it's capable of is the same, but you manage it different. You know, obviously with a PaaS service that you've kind of deployed somewhere versus Fabric, which is kind of this umbrella thingy, to use a very technical term.
I love it. Awesome. Cool. Well, I think the takeaway is, like, if you're using Fabric, you get the same thing in Fabric. If you're using Azure, go ahead and use it in Azure. Is that fair?
Yeah. I mean, it's wherever you are, you can play with it. And, you know, there's this sample data right here, and I just showed kind of the very basic one. We've got the classic taxi one, COVID data, geospatial, all sorts of interesting data sets that are well documented. So if you saw anything in here and you're like, well, this is cool, but it was just a few minutes, he didn't show me a lot, fantastic. Dive in here, you've got access, you don't have to spin anything up, and you're off and running.
Awesome, cool. Well, Matt, once again, thanks again for coming on the show. I learned a lot. That explain tip at the end is going to save me a lot of time. So thanks for that. If you're a viewer and you like this episode, go ahead and leave it a like. Leave us a comment and let us know what you think. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.